Thank you very much, Dr. Prahlad. Good afternoon to all the participants. In the next about 25 to 30 minutes, just want to take you on a guided tour as to how one has to go about the design cycle of future fighter aircraft. It cannot be very elaborate, and I would say more or less I have targeted it for the students and little popular type of talk. So the presentation would go over these following topics which I have put on the display: the introduction, the vision of future combat systems, how do we generate the requirements for the mission, and then from there we derive the technology options and what's there in the future technologies and the design methodologies are leading to a conclusion. First thing that anybody has to do in this game of designing the fighter aircraft to have an understanding of what are the missions that this particular aircraft that we are going to design is intended for. And the new buzzword is multi-role or swing role, probably one primary, then the secondary one or the tertiary one also. But that has to be fully understood and defined, which we have to properly consolidate with the customer. It could be any combinations of this. Time has to be spent on understanding this. The earlier one talked about the air-to-air and air-to-sea missions. It's a typical of a strike mission. Actually, it indicates three segments. The segments basically for a short-range, medium-range, and the long-range. But what's very important is not the range. What kind of threat environment in which the aircraft has to go through and come back successful. That is very important than the range. This particular view graph illustrates the kind of threat scenario and the target scenario. So threat scenario is what you have to make sure that you come back safely, and the target scenario is make sure to that you'll be able to successfully accomplish the mission against such protected targets. So this has to be done first. Once that is done, it gets into a little bit of technical activity. Up to that is what normally we do with the users, the Indian Air Force or the Indian Navy. But then comes the mission of the designer. He has to analyze the missions into various segments and then try to find out in each segment what is it that the operator is demanding. So for example, if you take a strike mission, we just indicated as an example in takeoff, cruise and strike, and then egress, strike and climb, climb and descent also. We could see that in cruise, depending on the mission, the low observability, the super cruise, a powerful radar, a good pilot's associate, the missile warning systems, the precision navigation equipment, a passive electro-optical sensors, a net sensor. These are all the demands which are coming. But even at that stage, these are demands, but they have to be quantified when you go to the next layer of design. But at least these things would emerge as the operator puts his requirements. In a typical air-to-air mission, in an analysis, again try to identify in order to give the best to the operator what exactly is required. He would be putting across his requirements, sometimes qualitatively, but then when the design starts, they get converted into quantitative numbers. I just consolidated here the qualitative aspects. And this is about a naval mission. The most important thing in the naval mission will be the takeoff and the landing. The takeoff could be from a ramp or it could be catapult. Deck landing is more or less common across the world with arrestor hooks. So this is the kind of mission and analysis that has to be done on that. So since the commonality exists between the Air Force and the naval variants for other parts of the mission segments, we just try to identify what really comes out to the technical design team is that in the takeoff and landing, the first and second blocks indicate the bulleted points of demands. And very important is that the most of the equipments, why not, I would say all the equipments will have to be designed for the marine environment. That's a challenge when we designed it for the marine or naval application. From there, we further derive as designers, okay, yes, pre-flight test time to be reduced. What it means, whatever pre-flight tests that we do, we should make sure that the aircraft is fully tested and the probability of detection is kept very high and the probability of false alarm should be kept very low. Easy to set, the amount of technical work that has to go into the detection of these failures of various equipments, consolidating them, putting through filters, and then finally annunciating to the pilot. All that is the detailed work of the designers, but at the highest level, they appear to be a demands of this nature. So this view graph just indicates in terms of various segments what are all the demands and what need to be done by the designer when he is trying to meet the demands. And further, when we go, as I said, low observable itself can be further decomposed into the low radar cross-section of the electromagnetic signatures, the infrared signatures, and in order to do that, what is required is in terms of certain technologies which is related to radar absorbent materials, radar absorbent structures newly coming up, and the paints. And some aerodynamic challenges like serpentine ducts still not having cavitation inside the ducts. So this is how the analysis has to be done for each of the demand which was derived from the various mission segment requirements. And for example, if you go to the combat phase, what is the demand? Supermaneuverability or agility to be very high, and the demands on the integrated flight and propulsion control are becoming more and more severe, and multifunctional air display system, air data sensors for very high angles of attack, and so on and so forth in terms of the sensors. This is how the derivation goes further down into more details. So I just wanted to indicate that is how we start with the scenario, mission analysis. The mission analysis would indicate what kind of requirements are coming to the designer, and that would actually now lead the designers to start the design activity. One thing is very clear, at least from the LCA program onwards, no design of a system is independent by itself. All the subsystems are highly interdisciplinary in nature. In fact, the background picture actually says how it's all crisscrossed with all the systems. Very important thing that one has to keep in mind in the design is the design methodology should take into many things into account. The first one talks about the design development cost itself. Okay, normally in a government-funded situation, when the restrictions are not really much, we tend to be overrated, too much of factor of safety, all that is fine. But if one day the product that we have designed has to be sold in the international market, then it has to stand the competition. As long as we have captive customer, no problem, but when you have to really take it into the global market, the first column also becomes very, very important. And the second and third are the realizations that we have had in the last about 5 years. Okay, if the product is not designed for these objectives of the operational cost and the maintenance cost, I think we are not good designers. As a matter of fact, I went to a foreign country, I will not say which one, then I tried to present about the LCA, blah, blah, blah. Finally, he asked only two questions. What is the cost of each flying hour? What is the maintenance cost for each flying hour? I had no answer. I never knew that, or I never realized that it has to be designed for such objectives also. We should normally we work it out and say, this is what has happened, you take it. But it has to be designed for the set targets, or try to achieve the set targets. So having had seen the objectives that designer has to keep it in mind, okay. But before actually the design starts, the designers will have in front of them various technology options, but the technology options will have to be studied, and then some decisions have to be made as to which technology option that we take. For example, the environmental control system, the first two blocks indicate, let us left to right, but the last one indicate what is the future in terms of all electric systems. So probably I think in future when we go for the advanced medium combat aircraft or some unmanned systems, we may think of using this rather than the conventional ones. And the onboard action generator system, okay, fine, it may not be really futuristic, but as the LCA program perceives it, since it's not there yet on the LCA aircraft, it is something that we consider, more or less we decide that, okay, this is an option that has to be there on the aircraft. Okay, and also, I don't really say that it is really futuristic, but the active fuel management system is very much important, and we have faced many problems in the LCA aircraft, which presently we understand by employing an active fuel management system, we could have solved this problem. This is a kind of technology option that more or less we are deciding for the future aircraft design in the programs. And the brake systems. The conventional hydraulic piston-based hydraulic brake systems may not be the future. All electric brake systems are under consideration, but we have to see the practicability of this for the fighter aircraft applications. But for civilian transport aircrafts, this is a choice. But the choice has to be made by the designer depending on the constraints and the technologies available for that particular application in terms of the speed of response and the heat generated during that brake applications. In terms of the air data sensors, the futuristic aircrafts are demanding flush air data systems so that they reduce the drag and they also reduce the impact on the radar which is there in the radome. That is one thing, flush air data sensors. But at another new way, new mechanism which the DRDO WADA have also funded, the laser-based system, the laser beams, they just penetrate into the atmosphere, measure the phenomena of the atmosphere in front of that atmosphere, actually the flow phenomena, and based on that, it's possible to derive the air data parameters. A project is given to some academic institutions, but it is not something really hype. It has been already done in abroad, and we are trying to get this technology also for consideration. The technology is mature, we'll consider this for the future aircrafts. And the flight control systems, even with respect to what we have got on the LC aircraft, what we call the 4+ generation, but still there is a lot of movement forward, the nonlinear controls and the learning and adaptive systems. Okay, so this again is going to be a new technology which probably I would say in our case we have made the option that this is what is going to be the control application for the future aircrafts. A little more elaboration of the flight control systems in future. They're going to be adaptive, fault tolerant, okay, increased use of nonlinear control techniques. These are just listed here. At this point of time, analysis has to be done as to what is available and decision has to be done. Probably in the case of the programs that ADA is handling, we have more or less decided these are the technologies that we are going to adopt. Okay, that's about technologies, but this is only a few samples of the technologies that I have mentioned, but one has to really go through the exhaustive for various hydraulic system, electrical system, or the fuel system, or environmental control system, or landing gear. For all these options are there, options have to be studied, options to be frozen before actually get into the design process. A very important thing that we would say is a modeling and simulation is very, very important in the process of any design cycle, and that would actually cut down the total cost of the development. I would reiterate that this has to be taken very seriously, but modeling is not very easy. But if it is taken upfront in the beginning of the program itself, it would come a long way. This particular view graph, if you go from left to right at the bottom, talks about various stages of design, okay, concept definition, design, fabrication. At every stage, the modeling and simulation is used, being used presently. Just it indicates, okay, to sum it up, what is there in the right side boxes? If the proper modeling and simulation is done, up front we detect the problems by very high fidelity simulators. Otherwise, we pay heavily during the last phases of the program. Fixing a bug in the last phases is very big pain. This is very important. I would like to reiterate. In any program, the knowledge engineering of the previous programs is very, very important. Okay, the knowledge has to be attracted for the 20-25 years. The LCA program has been going on, and we are thinking of a process through which we do the knowledge engineering and keep it as a legacy data to be used by the future designers. This is a very important thing that has to be kept in mind. And one who is going to design should always look for the legacy data, okay, which is authenticated so that it can be used. And the trend towards the multidisciplinary optimization has caught up. And as I said, since no system is a single system, it is all interdisciplinary system, the multidisciplinary optimization has come. The tools have also come into the practice, but the concept and the tools is not all. A lot of database has to be generated so that for a parametric variation and then studies, it should go to the database and get the solutions. That is what the industry should do, or a design house should do. But there's no other option except going for the MDO in future. A very important element for the design phase is that please design it for manufacturing. DFMEA is the concept. Gone are those days that you can go through some prototypes and then spend a lot of time and then start converting the prototypes into the limited series production and series production. Fine. People had time. And of course, we are also doing that. But in future, we are not going to do that. The concept of DFMEA is going to be used so that the first time design itself appropriate manufacturing and assembly. These are the features that normally one could take care if you follow the DFMEA technique. And as a part of this design exercise, the concept of digital mock-up has become a reality. And probably, I would say that even in India also in future, the metal cutting should not be allowed unless the digital mock-up is fully available, authenticated, certified that it is a final design and its realization in terms of the structural and the pipes and cabling, etc., is fully cleared for the manufacturing. A typical example of the digital mock-up, okay, the cutout, a small cutout indicates how in detail all the elements are brought in here. As a matter of fact, in some of the programs, the digital mock-up is used to that level that, okay, fine, you have decided all the parts. How to build the aircraft, which part to be put first and which part next is also decided. Also, if for a maintenance purpose, a subsystem or equipment has to be removed, what is the removal process and what is the installation process? All these things are completed as a study here itself and defined in the digital mock-up. We don't have to wait for the actual aircraft to be available. And the new definition is the model-based definition. That means probably I think very soon we may not be seeing in future the 2D drawings, all 3D models with all the data specified on the model-based definition itself. People may find it like a hype that it may not happen, but it is the transition that is happening. Most of the industries have almost shifted to the model-based definition, and 3D drawings, 2D drawings are no more available. So I just wanted to touch upon two case studies. One is related to the flight controller. As I said, I talked about the generic design trends in the future. Just wanted to take a case study how it is to be done for a flight control. These are the various step-by-step modules that one has to go through before he actually designs. These are all the various stages that one has to go. See how elaborately the process is to be followed. And I would like to say that, okay, thanks for the National Controller team. They have evolved this kind of processes which have given us a system which is very, very robust. So see the at the moment I think we have finished the PID test, and probably I think the answer is no more changes which are required. Okay, I'll just go to that. And see the interdisciplinary link of this particular flight control system. Most of the systems on the aircraft are interlinked. The simulation of this system requires the simulation of all these things. That's what I said, it is multidisciplinary system, and the process of designing is much more difficult. Another case study I have taken for the avionics system. Currently, I think the ARINC 661 is a process of designing avionics systems. These are the advantages. Okay, I think some of the speakers before I started here, I think they also mentioned that in future, the most of the prototyping is done, and just the cycles that have to be done will be reduced. Okay, a little more description of that particular system. And in terms of the environmental control system also, this is the kind of design process that one has to go through for the future. We have not done it earlier, but this is what is for the future. So in order to, after realization of the design, in order to validate, very important thing is to have this ground test facilities, very, very important, complete the testing on the ground and have no surprises in air. As a matter of fact, most in the flight control systems and the avionics system in the LCA program, we hardly get back from the flight anything worth really mentioning a serious snag. So that is where the ground simulators would play a very role. This is for the avionics system, and this is how we will be doing it for the avionics systems. The virtual reality is extensively used so that all the ergonomics have been captured at that stage. These are all the simulators where on the ground itself, the full-fledged avionics system is flown by the pilots, and then they make sure that, okay, it's acceptable. Similarly, this is what the avionics part, all the avionics equipment brought into hardware loop simulation, and the entire system gets tested on the ground itself. So these are the few other test facilities which are currently operational, but similar ones will have to be built for future developments, specific to those specific systems that we develop in the future. So this is what I would like to conclude, that the future trends are different from what we have done about, say, 2 decades ago. And it is time that the youngsters understand this and they start changing over. Especially, I would like to re-emphasize on the model-based system engineering, system development, system definition. Please change over to this kind of process. Take into the life cycle cost into the mind when you do the design. So this is what all the systems are going to be interdisciplinary, and we have to be careful to do this complex systems design. So with this, I think I'll close my talk.
Thank you very much, Subramanyam. You can't get a better person than Subramanyam to talk about fighter combat aircraft design. He made it fighter aircraft design simplified. Very nicely mentioned, and I don't think any serious question is there because we are slightly short of time, and we would like to thank Subramanyam.
Thank you.